Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Adorable Atrocity, an Alien Evolution Lit RPG by Zenkarn Cooper, narrated by Cat Gould. Chapter 1. Australian Outback Adventure, Erodicilee. Erodicilee trotted gleefully through the sand and dirt beside his mummy, his nose raised as he took in the strange scents of this new world. His tail wagged as he sniffed at the scrub and brush they passed. He took a deep breath as he studied a rock that smelled like a creature had passed by recently. A rumbling in his stomach made him pause and sniff the air as he tried to find something living nearby. The surrounding breeze ruffled the mass of fur that covered his entire body. Instead of a treat, he growled as the smell made him think of a predator. His small legs pumped as he veered away from his mummy and towards the potential threat. The source of the scent was long and flat. It slithered from beneath a fallen log with an extended hiss. Erodicilee's long ears flicked back, partially blocking the strange sound, as he growled back. In response, the new creature reared up and opened its mouth to display two prominent fangs as its forked tongue flicked in the air. His brown eyes met the newcomer's yellow ones. Neither moved until Erodicilee's fur started waving without the assistance of the wind. The pink strands twirled together into tendrils, but before either could attack, a pair of green-scaled arms scooped him from the ground. He let his fur tendrils fall apart as he wiggled into his mummy's embrace. Her yellow eyes, with their slit pupils so similar to the predator's, watched him as she bared her teeth, displaying her own two fangs. With a bark, he let his tongue loll out of his mouth. When she didn't pat him at his display, Erodicilee changed tactics and squirmed around to lick at her hands. With a snort, she changed her grip and he dangled in the air. "Bat boy!" She let out one of her strange, high-pitched barks. "What did Mummy tell you about eating the wildlife? You know we have to keep a low profile, and it's bad for your stomach." The sound travelled into his ears and down into his core, making him shiver with delight as his stomach did backflips. He'd loved that sound ever since he'd spotted her moments after he first hatched. She was his mummy, his world, and he'd let nothing happen to her. A loud bang cut off his train of thought, and he jerked his body around to see the predator lying in pieces. His attention shifted to one of her companions, a lanky yellow creature covered in strange cloth that stunk like constant fear. The noise had come from the square device with a transparent cap. When they turned towards his mummy, he let out a growl. The fear smell doubled, and they quickly hid the device. Erodicilee watched the creature, its three strange arms waving through the air as it approved. It stopped out of reach for his tendrils, and Erodicilee only paused his growling after she patted him. Her hands ran through his fur, and he couldn't resist the urge to purr. It felt so good. Any time she paused, he licked her hands again in the hope she'd restart.
"Really? I know you're a smuggler, but an assassination attempt?" his mummy barked, rubbing her hands along his ears.
"Of course not, my esteemed guest. Never. But I warned you."
The yellow creature's voice held a strange croaking quality to it that Erodicilee found distasteful.
"This region of Earth, what the natives called the Outback, is known for having the most dangerous animals. You need to be careful. Even humans who are non-native to this region understand this."
As it spoke, the white and brown cloth that covered its torso bulged in and out, making it look fat one moment and skinny the next.
"That is why I have my bodyguard. Julep can protect me from any threat."
At his mummy's words, the third member of their group stepped closer. Erodicilee let his tongue loll out once again and gave a happy yip at his approach. He knew this being. He was often with them when they went on walks. In a similar fashion to his mummy, scales covered his form. Though he had large muscles and a long snout filled with sharp teeth instead of her flatter face, He also wore a solid grey and white material that left his arms uncovered. Erodicilee had bitten it once and still remembered how hard it was. Erodicilee much preferred the softer white material that covered his mummy's upper body, though the brown material that covered her legs was nice to gnaw at and dislodge things from his teeth. However, she pushed him away whenever he tried for too long. Mummy's friend also carried a device similar to the yellow creature. However, he'd slotted his into a brown band that ringed one of his arms. Erodicilee blinked at him and then kicked his paws in the air to get closer. His pats weren't as good as his mummy's, but Erodicilee wasn't about to miss out. As he strained, he noticed the subtle spike of fear filling the air as the newcomer moved away from him.
"Please do not shoot at your client. I don't believe I should need to tell you that."
Again, the yellow creature waved its three appendages through the air as its body inflated and deflated. The bulbous eyes protruding from the top of its bulbous head twirled around before it dropped face first onto the ground with all its arms outstretched. Erodicilee sniffed the air and barked. He didn't understand why the creature was marking its territory here, but he didn't like it.
"I am sorry, but this trip makes me nervous. I have never had an esteemed guest such as you with me. All I wish for is your safety."
The stench of excitement from the display wafted from his mummy, and Erodicilee's tail wagged energetically behind him. He loved it when his mummy was pleased. Her being happy made him happy. He loved being happy, the fresh smells, and the treats he could smell nearby. With a yip, he buried his nose into the cloth container she carried slung over her shoulder. She made a rhythmic barking sound that often accompanied the current scent.
"Is Mummy's boy hungry? Is that why you disobeyed Mummy?"
He yipped when she repeated that bark, as he knew he should. That earned him a strange cooing sound as she placed him on the ground. Without needing to be told, he reared up on his hind legs and stuck out his tongue. His fur waved about him as he spun around on his hind legs. She slapped her scaled hands together, and only once she stopped did he turn to face her, mouth open.
"Good boy."
Erodicilee panted and resisted the urge to leap at the treat tube she pulled out and held aloft. Only when she tossed it up did he spring up, landing well before it did as he caught it in his mouth. Fur moved out to wrap around it, keeping it steady as he devoured the snack. It tasted like blood and meat and made his rumbling stomach go quiet. While he focused on his meal, he allowed himself to drop back onto all fours as he listened to his mummy bark with the others.
Should you be feeding him meat?"
The warbling creature barked as it rose from the dirt. Red dust stained the brown that covered his legs, and he used two of his appendages to wipe at it. His mummy repeated that rhythmic sound.
"Please, there isn't a single living creature's meat in that tube. The creators designed it specifically for my precious boy." "And no disrespect to the esteemed guest, but you don't find that terrifying?"
Fear wafted from the creature, and his mummy snapped his fingers. With a quick gulp to finish his treat, Erodicilee flipped onto his back and spread out his legs. He yipped and snuffled as he wiggled about. It was a trick his mummy had taught him whenever she brought other creatures to their home. They all loved it.
"Why would I find my little darling scary? You can pat him.
Go ahead."
"I would not be worthy to touch the honoured guest's pet."
Erodicilee watched as the other creature shook and moved further away before he turned his back on them.
"Come, we should keep moving. Though rare, sometimes natives venture this far out. If we hurry, we can make it to some interesting rock art."
"Rock art?" his mummy barked, even as she lifted him once more under her arm.
"Yes, it's an ancient custom for humans. They paint the caves with various signs and declarations. Some are thousands of years old. A favourite amongst my clients visiting this region."
"Isn't that exciting, my beautiful boy?"
Erodicilee yipped again, sharing his mummy's joy at the situation, even as she tucked him back under her arm next to the treat container. Once more, they trekked across the flat land, and Erodicilee relaxed as he sniffed at the air again. The smells had changed a little, and he let his tongue hang out as his mummy's long-term companion spoke.
Lecorondia, ma'am.
His voice was low, almost a growl.
Do you remember the escape route if we need it?
Of course. Olif here will teleport us to his ship at the first sign of trouble. Relax. There is nothing out here. If there was, Erodicilee would sniff it out. Wouldn't you, boy?
Erodicilee yipped as she raised him in the air before slowly spinning. He'd recognized one word in her barking language and sniffed at the air before sorting the various scents. Dry air, decaying plant life, fresh meat, stone, and sweat. He let out a quick warning bark and she paused. His eyes wide, Erodicilee stared at the rock she'd pointed him toward. Another sniff and he growled. There was something alive in that direction, and it was big. The creature stepped around the rock before he got another chance to intimidate the threat. It was round and pale, with red fur covering its head and face. Sand-coloured splotches covered the cloth that strained against its body's bulk. In its hands was a black rectangle with a transparent end. As it raised the rectangular device, the creature let out a howl.
Aliens! Aliens! Aura's right!
The muscular green-scaled creature shoved his mummy back and Erodicilee found himself dropped to the ground. As he fell, he noticed the third member running towards them, holding a device in his appendages that he'd not seen before. Then the ambusher made another barking sound and the device flashed. His mummy screamed and a cocktail of adrenaline and rage filled Erodicilee. He charged at the unfamiliar creature, barking and howling as his fur thrashed around him. Determination filled him, and his small legs pumped as he hurtled toward this new threat. His mummy yelled, but he didn't turn back. She needed him to protect her from this new threat. A growl escaped his throat as he continued to run. It had hurt her. That was unacceptable. The newcomer howled before it started wobbling away, and Erodicilee breathed in its fear. He bit at the air, readying his jaws to taste proper meat for the first time. This monster would pay for daring to attack his mummy. As he rounded the rock, he spotted the creature sitting on another beast. Its large black and red body was reflective, and it towered over him. Not that such a thing stopped Erodicilee's attack. His fur twisted in front of him, and he tossed himself at it. A squeal of pain tore from his throat as the beast's hot skin burned him. He bounced off the hard shell, sand covering his fur as he rolled away. With a growl, he righted himself as he moved behind the creature, ready for the next attack. That was when the creature struck back. Its roar was high-pitched, and a cloud of foul-smelling black smoke billowed from its tail. Erodicilee coughed, unable to smell anything aside from the acrid stench. His fur writhed, but before he could launch them, the beast kicked sand directly into his face, blinding him. Several moments passed before he regained his vision, and both his attackers had vanished by then. As he peered around, he noticed their tracks. His ears twitched and he barked as he heard the same high-pitched roar in the distance. Erodicilee attempted to sniff them out, but the acrid smell burned into his nose. He whined and scratched at his snout. When that didn't work, he stumbled back around the rock, ready to check on his mummy. He knew she'd be proud of him. She'd give him treats and pats and spoil him. His stomach growled at the thought of treats. However, as he laid eyes on the spot his mummy should be, there was nothing. Neither his mummy, nor the big-scaled one, or the scared yellow one were anywhere in sight. He tried to sniff, and when that failed once again, he listened for her voice. Nothing. With a soft thump, Erodicilee sat in a puff of dirt. Despair filled him, and he howled the emotion into the open air as he waited for his mummy to come back to collect him. Chapter 2 Chasing Evolution, Erodicilee. His mummy did not reappear. Erodicilee continued howling while pawing at his nose until his sense of smell returned. It was gradual, but soon he started sniffing around. Anxiety flooded him as he scampered, his ears flattening as he searched. He stopped at a section of earth when he detected the faintest traces of his mummy. With an excited howl, he dug into that spot, his paws aching with the effort. Sand flew around him as he dug. A whine escaped his muzzle when his mummy didn't appear. Erodicilee sat next to his hole and looked around. She hadn't reappeared. His stomach growled. Once again, he scoured the area, eventually heading back to the battlefield. The creature's strange, singular track remained, along with the lingering scent of its smoke attack. Erodicilee growled as he made sure the beast hadn't come back. He knew it might. The ambusher had appeared without warning. His fur writhed as he growled. He refused to be surprised again. When no signs of either the ambusher, its beast, or his mummy appeared, he sat in the sand with a soft thump. The fact that the creature that hurt his mummy had vanished made his ears droop as he let out a high-pitched whine. He knew the ambusher was responsible, it and the smelly beast. The ambusher held a device similar to that the yellow companion had used to kill the predator. That meant it might be capable of the same level of destruction. A protective urge filled him, and he looked around. If the creature was capable of such things, he needed to grow strong enough to protect his mummy. He jerked, almost leaping into the air, as an explosion of new instincts assaulted him. His insides writhed and his stomach growled. A sniff told him the fresh meat scent lay in the same direction as the tracks. Energy filled him as he trotted off across the sands, though a different type than when he'd attacked the ambusher. Instead of aggression, excitement filled him, the same sensation as when his mummy took him for walks or presented treats. As he hunted, his mouth watered as he focused on his future meal. His fur rippled as his instincts whispered about the strength he would gain, how beneficial his new diet would be for him. Upon finding the location of the pleasant scent, his nose wrinkled at the foul scent that accompanied it. The worst smell emanated from a creature that lay unmoving on the ground. Its body flattened in the middle, while other parts bulged out. Around it, black specks moved back and forth through the air, emitting a strange buzzing noise. Erodicilee paused, noticing the way the creature's stillness attracted the specks of meat. He knew the strategy well. His mummy often praised him when he sat still and allowed her companions to touch him. It appeared it could act as a good hunting strategy as well. With his mind made up, he moved a few inches closer and sat down. At his approach, the black specks went crazy. Some ran from the area entirely, while others whirled through the air. Through it all, Erodicilee stayed still and silent. His efforts paid off as one of the black meat specks landed on his head. It weighed nothing, and the way its multiple legs tramped made his fur want to move. Erodicilee willed it to remain still, waiting for the perfect chance to strike. It came seconds later. With a buzz, the creature rose into the air. Strands of fur shot up and around the creature, cocooning it and dragging it back to his body. Without thinking, he licked his snout, his stomach growling as the fur writhed. Strands twisted and unraveled as they passed the meat toward his mouth. Slowly, he dropped his jaw and allowed the fur to deposit the morsel before he quickly snapped his jaw shut. The creature buzzed, throwing itself against his teeth. With a quick press of his tongue, he crushed it against the roof of his mouth. Strange juices squirted as he quickly swallowed the tiny creature. An explosion of sensations overwhelmed him. Erodicilee fought to stop the violent jerks that ravaged his body. His eyes remained locked on the other black specks as he digested his meal. Inside his stomach, heat radiated outward before concentrating on certain sections of the body. The pads of his paws burned against the sand, and his eyes welled up with tears, even as he continued to spasm with every heat flash. A whine escaped him as he squeezed his eyes shut and tried to get the burning in his paws to subside by dancing on the spot. His paws burned painfully for a second more before the entire sensation vanished. Erodicilee yipped as he sat and shook his head. More instincts hit him about the ways his body could move that were simultaneously unfamiliar and obvious. He shuffled in excitement as the knowledge settled inside of him. The treats that sat on the cold box would now be reachable. Once more, his stomach growled, and he returned to his previous spot, sitting still and watching the black specks. The mass of them had lessened, but he remained hungry, even after his snack. When the next one landed on him, he snapped it up and quickly gulped it down. This time, there was no explosive burst. Erodicilee didn't let that dissuade him, as his growling stomach demanded more. By the time he'd finished eating all the specks, the sun was setting. With his last bite, the sensation hit him again. It was less volatile this time, even as he jerked and his eyes filled with tears. He focused on his eyes, whining and pouring at them. When he opened them next, he fell over with a terrified yelp. All of his surroundings were now visible, including where he'd come from. When he spun, he found nothing changed. His fur shifted, and he pawed at the dirt until the understanding of his upgraded vision settled into his mind. He turned and focused on the tracks that ran alongside him. Excitement filled him as he bounded along with them while he kept a lookout for somewhere to sleep. With this new vision, he could always see his mummy wherever they were. Now he couldn't miss her by accident. Two tall rocks rose to his left as he continued to follow the tracks, with a gap near the top he could fit in. He veered away from the track and moved to the rocks. With a wiggle, he jumped, feeling his feet stick to the side of the rough stone. His fur waved in the slight breeze as he made his way to the top and crawled into the crack. He shivered in the chilly night air as he tucked his legs underneath him and faced the opening. His new awareness of his surroundings instantly shut off when he closed his eyes. A whine escaped him as he fell asleep, and his fur wafted in the breeze as he dreamed of all the walks he'd gone on with his mummy. Erodicilee's growling stomach woke him from his pleasant dreams as the scent of fresh meat invaded his small sleeping cave. His fur writhed sluggishly as a yawn escaped his lips. Without opening his eyes, he sniffed at the air, seeing if he could detect any hints of his mummy's presence along with his future breakfast. He growled when he couldn't and sat up, opening his eyes. His surroundings filled his awareness once again as he exited the cave. It was time to hunt. The target, thankfully, wasn't far, so he carefully crept across towards the rocks it lay on. The creature was smaller than him, but larger than the black specks, making it a filling meal. He couldn't stop himself from salivating at the prospect. His instincts screamed at him to hurry. Erodicilee knew they were right. He couldn't miss this opportunity to grow in strength and to make his mummy proud of him. Spikes covered the rock-coloured creature, peppering its back and the small legs protruding from its long body. Its two bulbous eyes fixed on him as he approached. He let his tongue hang out and paused, waiting as he did with the flies. The creature stared at him and he stared back. Time passed, but it didn't jump on him like his last meal. His fur rustled, and he took an extra step forward in case he needed to be closer. It let loose a squeaking bark as it got bigger, its legs extending as its sides expanded. Erodicilee barked back, which made it move side to side in a rhythmic dance. Joy rushed through him.
He knew this trick. His mummy loved watching him move to impress the others that came to their home. At his movements, the creature stopped and let out another squeaking bark. Before Erodicilee could copy the sound, it ran off. He chased, kicking up dirt as he hunted down his prey. They ran past some rocks and the creature scurried up the side. From its position, it barked, and Erodicilee stopped to stare at it. He barked back, then threw himself forward and climbed after it. It tried to scurry away, but not fast enough. With speed, his fur shot forward and wrapped around one of its back legs. It barked and pulled, and he did the same in the opposite direction. Bits of his fur snapped, and he moved forward to reinforce his grip. The creature wriggled, unsure how to deal with the lack of force pulling it back. The creature's indecision was all he needed to capitalize. More fur shot out, grabbing it and dragging it further as he climbed back to the ground. Step by step, he pulled his prey closer until it was half wrapped by fur as it hung about him. His stomach gurgled and his instincts sang as he dragged the creature into his open mouth. The crunch was loud in the otherwise silent surroundings. It took him multiple bites to consume the entire thing, and only when he'd finished did he get the familiar sensation of his instincts exploding. This time, the heat didn't move to certain sections of his body. It fanned out, filling him entirely until he flipped onto his back and rolled about, hoping to make it stop. To his relief, it did. Instincts relating to his body flooded him, telling him to eat if injured. As he wiggled in excitement, he could feel the slight scorching from the hot dirt on his paws fade as he digested his meal. Satisfaction surged through him as he basked in the triumph of his successful hunt. Pleased with his new powers, he turned to follow the ambush's tracks once again. Erodicilee blinked and then ran in a small circle. They were gone. He'd lost the trail. With a low whine, he quickly tried to find his way back to the cave, but his long fur brushed away any of his own markings. He was lost again. Erodicilee sniffed, trying to see if he could locate the acrid smell the creature left off. All he got instead was the scent of wet earth and fresh vegetation. His tongue hung from the side of his mouth as he panted. He knew those smells. They meant water was nearby. With the sun beating down overhead, he rushed towards it. All creatures needed to drink. Perhaps the ambusher would be there, or better yet, his mummy. As he drew closer, his stomach growled. Other meat sources were nearby, and a big one at that. His ears picked up the sounds of movement and rushing water as he drew closer to his destination. He sat, stunned, as he watched water pour down a series of rocks into a pool below. Greenery surrounded it, tremendously different from the bare earth that he'd walked through so far. With a careful scan, he didn't see any creatures, though he smelled one nearby. Erodicilee let out a yip as he moved toward the water. Once again, he stopped, searching around. All he saw was a log drifting by itself. Unconcerned, he lapped at the water before pulling away with a yelp. The log had teeth and was coming right for him. Progression. Evolutions. 360-degree vision. Flies. Sticky feet. Flies. Limb regeneration. Lizard. Chapter 3. Differing Perspectives. Lecorondia. Lecorondia watched Julep's teeth glisten in the ship's overhead light as he pressed Olif closer to the wall. The bog-dweller-turned-smuggler shook, his single leg dangling off the floor as he raised his arms as if to show he wasn't a threat. Not that he would be. She watched as Julep reached towards the antimatter blaster on his arm. One shot and no witnesses would remain. Unfortunately, her guide remained necessary, for now. "Do you understand what you've done?" Lecorondia asked, her tone one of perfect calm as she settled onto the dingy couch. It took effort, but she refused to show her disdain. Her smile remained civil, looking exactly like the ones that decorated the multiple posters on the wall. A kernel of disgust filled her. Often she found herself loathing her fans, but he'd wormed his way into her good graces by offering a generous discount for his services. It was amazing what she could accomplish with her name and a smile.
"Honourable guest, please, I acted as your bodyguard requested. You signed the..."
"I understand the forms I signed." Her eyes narrowed and her tail flicked out behind her. The brown leather skirt she wore shifted around her. "But I believe we are missing someone, are we not?"
"My esteemed guest, if..."
Lecorondia raised a hand and Julep pressed Olif further into the wall. His grey and white body armour shifted as the muscles in his arms bulged. She briefly let her gaze travel over them. Truly, the geneticists back home did amazing work. Momentarily, all that filled the silence was the ship's engines gently humming. Her gaze flicked to the window, where she watched the blue planet spin beneath them. Her annoyance at having her trip cut short overshadowed her delight at the sight, not to mention the potential ramifications of the press discovering her here. The scandal. No, this needed to be handled. If she couldn't keep this under wraps, they would all be in serious trouble. That started with making her guide understand how dire this was.
"Do you understand the issue of leaving my precious baby back there all by his lonesome? How will the Galactic Government react if they learn his capabilities? You thought they were afraid of him before. What's coming may be so much worse."
Her forked tongue flicked out and tasted the air. Fear. It took all of her focus not to shiver in delight. However, hundreds of hours before the camera had taught her to school her expression. Instead, she pulled out her compact and checked herself over. As she played with her hair, she watched Olif's eyes somehow bulge more. Good. She replaced her compact in her handbag, and her hand brushed over Erodicilee's stack of treats. Her heart panged at the loss, though she hid that too. No need to let the help watch her squirm. "Now, we are in a slight situation. What scanners do you have on board? We need to find him." Olif's body bulged as Julep's grip lessened and he could finally take in a proper breath. His croaking voice wavered as he answered, his words quick.
"Your perfection, please! No scanners adorn my ship. The authorities discovering such things would harm the guest experience."
"Julep?"
"He's right, ma'am. I checked when we got on board."
From the way Olif's eyes swiveled, it seemed he hadn't noticed her guards snooping. It seemed the credits she'd spent were paying off in spades. Still, she resisted the urge to bite her lip. Her precious baby could eat anything without her supervision, a state of affairs she'd so carefully avoided so far. Lecorondia looked towards Julep. "You have a local scanner?"
"Yes, ma'am."
"Good. Olif, return Julep to the planet aunt for him." "Julep, do not return empty-handed." To his credit, the hesitation that her guard displayed was brief. She knew he knew what might await him, but he'd be fine. Her darling pet had socialized with him enough not to act hostile. Besides, she was wealthy enough to purchase another if things turned dire. It's amazing what the peasant will pay for, if you smile right.
"The teleporters are not working yet. Oh, wonderful guest," Olif blathered. "The emergency jump drained power, and it will take time to fully charge again."
Lecorondia's eyes narrowed, and she watched the bog dweller squirm. Her tongue flicked out as she tasted the air once again. She could smell him, his fear, and the adrenaline that coursed through him. Old instincts filled her, but she suppressed them. Civilized expectations carried punishments that acted as a wonderful deterrent. How long, exactly?
My apologies to my venerated guest. It will take time, a day at most in local time.
Lecorondia shot to her feet, tail smacking the couch hard enough to make it shift.
A day? My darling baby will be on his lonesome for a day.
Tears welled in her eyes, and she sniffed loudly as she strode to the window. The reflection in the glass showed off the way Olaf's eyes spun wildly on top of his strange head.
Please, perhaps I can make it sooner. Please, honoured, great, fantastic guest.
It might not be enough. She made sure her voice cracked before she spoke the next sentence.
My poor baby, all alone. No, do not cry, wonderful guest. Please, I shall work hard for you.
She sobbed again, even as she raised her hands to cover her face. It wouldn't do to let him see her smiling.
Would you? I would. Anything for you.
Julep.
I'll monitor him, ma'am.
The sound of a sliding door opening and shutting sounded in rapid succession as their footsteps faded. When she was sure they were gone, she moved over to the couch. With a vicious movement, she tossed one cushion against the wall opposite her. It thumped into the metal wall, and she spun, claws raking across the poster. It displayed her smiling while wearing a chef's hat, a scene from the movie Kitchen Love.
Idiots! Fools! Failures!
Lecorondia growled as she paced the room. Her eyes flicked to the planet as she paced once more towards the window. She pressed a hand against the glass. Her baby roamed down there, doing who know what. If those fools who considered themselves in charge figured out that she'd left such a dangerous life form on such a primitive planet, she could kiss all her hard work goodbye. That was unacceptable.
Don't worry, baby, she whispered,
as she stared at the tiny planet below with its glowing lights.
Mummy's coming.
Lecorondia ran a hand over her white blouse as she watched Julep stand in one of the teleporter bays. He carried his antimatter blaster, a small communicator, and a tracking device, the latter of which Olaf generously donated to the cause after she'd spent the dinner charming him with stories. Are you prepared?
Yes, ma'am,
Julep nodded as he checked himself over one more time.
He can't have gotten far with his legs.
He does have such cute little paws, Lecorondia cooed as she gestured for Olaf to hit the switch. The bog dweller nodded, and he hopped forward as he gestured to the screen.
My honoured guest, you will be able to watch his trip on the monitor provided, if that is to your satisfaction.
Of course it is. Lecorondia resisted the urge to snap at him. Julep sniffed.
Press the button. Yes, sir, of course, as you command.
Lecorondia rested in the room's singular small chair as she watched the screen. Her own face currently filled the massive screen, a familiar experience. With a nod of her head, Olaf hit the button and Julep vanished in an electronic buzz and flash of light. She blinked, not ready for the brightness that now filled the screen.
He made it safely, oh, esteemed guest, back to exactly where we left.
Good. I hope he finds my baby. Mummy's precious boy is so valuable to her. The consequences of not finding him quickly could be disastrous. I'm not sure I could hold myself together.
Olaf shivered. And this time, she didn't bother to hide her smile as she continued to watch the screen. Julep stepped behind the rock, the camera showing tracks left behind by the primitive Earth vehicle. Small tracks next to it showed that Erodicilee had followed them, though they were haphazard, his long fur brushing the trail to hide his tracks. Most of the footage was travelling. Julep sprinted along the sand, his head twisting as he looked around. The teleporter room was quiet, aside from Olaf's breathing. She ignored it, her eyes focused on the screen. If signs of her darling appeared, she wanted to see them first. Julep's first stop was at the scene of a murder. Her breath hitched, but she realised something had hit the creature. Erodicilee, she knew, wouldn't have left a corpse.
What is that? Lecorondia asked as Julep continued his search.
Oh, a hopping mouse. Harmless,
Olive croaked as his hands trembled over the controls. Did? No. She cut him off before he could ask the question. Julep moved again, once more speeding across the flat earth. Once or twice more, he stopped, checking the ground before arriving at a pair of rocks. Her hand rose to her mouth as she watched the screen. Small, familiar paw prints covered the sheer rocks leading upwards to a cave. That was new. Nerves filled her as she watched Julep scale the rocks and peer inside. There were no signs of her baby, nor were there any bloodstains. A sigh of relief escaped her. Perhaps he'd only eaten something small then. That should mean he'd be nearby. She clapped in excitement as Julep climbed back down and looked around the area. He paused, spotting two sets of tracks, Erodicilee's and something he was chasing. She waited with bated breath as her bodyguard moved after the pair. Once more, he arrived at a large rock, at the base of which lay several droplets of red blood alongside several pink fur strands. Worry churned in her stomach as she watched Julep scrutinize the area. Olive croaked, and she turned to him with a glare. When he'd flattened himself against a wall, she returned to watching the screen. Julep held up the strands, and his voice crackled from the screen.
Good news, ma'am. Whatever he ate didn't hurt him. I found more tracks.
Her sigh of relief filled the room as she watched him start again. More tracks, this time Erodicilee alone, clearly going at a slower pace. It was difficult to tell where her baby thought he was headed. The vehicle tracks were in a different direction entirely. Only when the scrub got thicker as the vegetation grew did she realize her darling's plan. He'd need water, of course, and this would be an excellent opportunity. She smiled as Julep continued getting closer. Erodicilee would probably play by the water. Her bodyguard would grab him, and they could all go home. Yes, it would all be fine. The area took her breath away. Clear water fell from the rocks into a large pool that caught the water before tipping it down to another waterfall. It was such a picturesque setting that she turned to Olive with wonder. Why didn't you show me this?
It was on the way, oh esteemed guest. Those rock paintings are...
A native beast sliding from the water interrupted him. Its grey hide blended in well with the surroundings until it opened its mouth full of sharp teeth. With a quick lunge, it tried to grab Julep. Her bodyguard acted quickly, jumping backward and drawing his blaster as he fired. The creature exploded.
Complex,
Julep swore as he looked around. She initially believed it was the shock of the attack until she saw it. A sob escaped her lips even as her whirling thoughts were still, unable to do anything else but stare at the scene. A small leg lay by the pool, wrapped in pink fur and speckled with green blood.
My baby, she whispered,
even as the tears dripped over her cheeks. Chapter 4. Illegal Fishing. Erodicilee. Erodicilee whimpered at the pain that radiated through him as the water pushed him further down the rocks. Any time he got the chance, he jammed his feet against the surface and took a lungful of air. His fur writhed around him, strands wrapping around the stump where the log had bitten off his leg. A whimper escaped him at the thought as the rushing water dislodged him from his perch once again. He fell further, momentarily catching himself and managing a deep breath before falling into the large pool of water with a splash. His eyes stung and he thrashed about when he hit something soft, a murky brown floating up around him. Instincts screamed at him to feed as he desperately attempted to push himself back toward the surface. Nearby, something silver flashed, and his fur surged to grab it. However, he found his attacks were slower and weaker, and the creature darted away. Panic filled him. his hunger and his desire to breathe merging into one all-consuming desire for life. He wanted to live, to return to his mummy for treats and attention. His eyes stung, but he kept them open, searching desperately for any signs of life. Blackness encroached on all sides as he kicked, trying to reach the surface for air. Then, a solid mass caught in his writhing fur. He pulled it into his mouth, ignoring it as it wiggled and writhed. With a violent constriction of his throat, he swallowed it whole, choking on the unyielding outer layer. An explosion of sensation filled him as the heat radiated around his neck and feet. His thoughts centered on breathing and receiving the slightest amount of that life-giving air. A tearing sensation covered his neck, even as his insides churned and shifted. Then, breath filled his lungs along with the water. Erodicilee let himself sink as he struggled with the strange sensation of inhaling water and receiving air. The sides of his neck pulsed each time he swallowed, and he barked, letting out a series of bubbles that streamed toward the surface. He watched them rise, repeating the sound whenever they stopped flowing. One popped, and he flinched before backing away from the new ones that appeared at his growl. The movement made him notice his balance and the recent growth that appeared where his old leg once sat. Strands of his fur remained wrapped around it, though looser than when the green liquid had poured out of him. Now that he was paying attention, he could feel it itching. A feeling deep inside him told him that would stop once he consumed more meat. His extended vision allowed him to watch the meat that moved above him. Long, thin things with strange tails and bulging eyes that had no trouble breathing in the water. He tried to jump, his paws kicking, but the weight of his sodden fur dragged him back until he sat in the mud again. Erodicilee sniffed, trying to locate any closer creatures. Water rushed in instead, leaving him woozy and light-headed. Once his head cleared, he went back to breathing through his mouth as he decided on a course of action. He would again try his first ever hunting tactic, letting the creatures approach him. With careful movements, he lay on his stomach and let the brown muck cover up his lower half. There, he waited, eyes open despite the discomfort, as he waited for the creatures to move closer to him. The longer he stayed underwater, the more natural the sensation of breathing became. A sense of calm washed over him as he sat and listened to the water and the occasional splash above him. His stomach growled, and he couldn't help but watch the life-giving meat swim outside his reach. As he was about to give up and try jumping again, a larger creature floated towards him. It was flat, like the others, and it seemed interested in the way his tentacles slowly waved about above them. Its strange mouth gaped open and closed as it nibbled at the series of strands. Erodicilee waited, letting the creature carefully creep closer until it was all but nestled amongst the strands. Then he struck. More strands wound around the creature's weird tail and body as he pulled it closer. It thrashed, and he used more strands to keep a grip on it. Though it fought, he eventually got it around to his front. His mouth opened, and he bit down to find his teeth grinding against a tough outer layer. The creature continued to struggle, slapping its tail against his mouth even as he bit on it. Additional strands entered the fray, pulling and turning the creature as he tried to understand how to get the best grip. As he tugged, his teeth caught and pulled something hard off its body. He let out a muffled growl as the small object slid down his throat, and he tasted the delicious meat that appeared. With that realization, he rubbed the creature over his teeth, letting the hard outer layer flake away until only a small amount remained. When he bit down this time, the taste of delicious flesh flooded his mouth as a reward. His yelp of delight caused more bubbles to rise before he started devouring the now defenseless creature. The explosive sensation filled him, and he shifted about as three different sections heated, his paws, his fur, and his eyes. With a growl, he nipped at his fur and felt the heat disappear. As it did, he knew his weight had changed, and he noticed a shimmer run over his fur that soon vanished. Instinct murmured about how he could survive more attacks now, like the creature. Excitement poured through him, doubling as he noticed his leg stump was back to being a full paw. It didn't feel as strong as it had been, but it was back. Now he could return to check on where the bitey log had lived. His mummy may be there and in danger. The ambusher would require water, as would its beast. Plus, he knew the tracks he'd followed had been around there, somewhere. Brown muck lowered his visibility as he searched for a way to return to the surface. Above him, creatures scattered, but in his excitement, he didn't pay them any mind. All he could think about was the search and his recently gained advantages. Before, his mummy hadn't allowed him to join her when she dipped herself in the pool of water inside the smelly room. She'd made him sit beside her after the time he'd fallen in and thrashed about. He'd not enjoyed it then, but now he knew he would be safe. That meant he could protect her from any dangers that might spring from her personal pool. No bitey log would get past him again. His excitement kept him moving, bubbles appearing in a constant stream as he attempted to yip and bark. However, eventually he knew it was time to rise again, no matter how much fun he was having. He'd had no luck so far finding the rocks he'd fallen down, and the ambusher and its beast were unlikely to be underwater. Even the biting log had floated nearer to the top. A thrill of fear passed through him, but he fought his way through it. He was stronger now, and his mummy needed him. His stomach growled at the thought, and his instincts urged him to continue to grow in power. If he encountered another bitey log, the ambusher, or anything else powerful, he'd need to be prepared. Filled with determination, Erodicilee half-climbed and half-swam towards the surface, ready to find those tracks again. His new sticky paw ability was his saving grace as he clawed himself onto dry land. He shivered, shaking himself to get rid of some of the excess water that clung to him and soaked his fur. When he tried to wave them around to dry, he discovered they refused to budge, simply sliding around his drenched torso. A whine escaped him as he limped away from the pool of water and towards a bright, sunny spot where he could dry off. Water pooled around his feet as he lay on his side on the warm rock that he'd found. Once or twice, he tried to sniff his surroundings, but found his nose clogged with muck, which forced him to breathe hard to dislodge it. Soon, muck, water, and loose strands of his fur covered the area around his rock. When he could smell it again, he sniffed the air and paused. He sniffed again. Then, a third time, for good measure. A low and dangerous growl escaped his throat as the familiar stink of the ambusher's beast came to him, though there was a distinct scent to it that he didn't understand. Not that he cared. The creature who dared hurt his mummy had returned and was close by. Strength surged through him, and he hopped off the rock and stalked forward. He kept his eyes open, his extended vision, making sure that nothing could sneak up on him. However, with the creature's ability to appear with little warning, it might not help. Further, he travelled, the smell growing stronger, until he heard the sounds of strange barking. He paused, his fur still wet against his body, as his weak leg protested the energetic movement. The deeper of the two barks sounded out, and Erodicilee crept closer. "I'm telling you, babe, no one comes out here. It'll be fine."
"But it's your dad's truck, Derek. He'll notice it's missing, and he grounded you for a month last time."
This bark was high-pitched, similar to his mummy's. A ripple of excitement filled him as he continued to stalk towards the sounds. Perhaps one of her companions was here. They had different barks too.
Another sniff at the air told him that the beast was nearby and was currently using its strange stink to attack. He didn't growl, wanting to stay unnoticed until he could grab it. The barking continued, the high-pitched one letting out a repetitive sound even as he smelled the familiar excitement wafting toward him. That smell and sound, combined, meant treats. Erodicilee abandoned the stealth approach and ran towards the barking sounds and the beast. What he discovered was not his mummy. Two creatures, similar to the ambushers, stood next to a much bigger version of the ambushers' beast. One had long yellow fur and wore a strange pink cloth that went from the top of her torso to near her lower paws. The other had shorter brown hair, a brown cloth wrapped around his torso, and a white cloth around each leg. Dirt covered the strange white cloth with a string that covered his lower paws.
Oh my God! Derek! Look at it! What is that? It's so cute!
The yellow-furred one cried out, grabbing onto the beast and pulling out a familiar device.
Hell if I know. Get a picture!
Erodicilee threw himself sideways as something flashed. He howled, ambling away as fast as he could. Behind him, small roars filled the air before the stench attack grew in intensity. He could hear the two barking, but it was all meaningless noise. These strange cloth-covered ambushers carried dangerous weapons.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.